Afternoon, once again. My name is Adriana Wawrzyniak, and I am working in Solaris National Synchrotron Center at the Jagiellonian University in Krakow. So today I will present you the introduction to the synchrotron sources. Okay, just I have some technical problems. Okay, I hope that you see that it is changing the slides.
Yes, we are.
Okay. Regarding the lecture, first of all, of course, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me and give the possibility to present this lecture. I will say some short introduction, and then I will go through the what it is synchrotron radiation, what does it mean, what types of the synchrotron radiation do we have. Then I will go a little bit about, talk about the history of the synchrotrons, and come to the synchrotrons that are now operating, which are the third and the fourth generation light sources. And in the end, I will show you some examples of the research at the, let's say, synchrotron radiation facilities. And then I will summarize my talk. So thinking about the light, we are usually thinking about the electromagnetic radiation and electromagnetic waves. If you look at this chart here, you will see that actually the electromagnetic radiation, it has a very broad spectrum from the kilometers, so to say, up to the very short values of the wavelengths, 10 to minus 12 meters. And we see that there are different types of those radiation that are used at different, let's say, categories. And if so, we have the radio waves, which we used widely in the broadcasting. So we have antennas, we have some transmitters, the television, radio. This is something that we know from the, let's say, normal life. Then we also have microwaves. They are in the centimeter, let's say, region. And the microwaves, of course, we are also widely used, especially in the now in the general life for the mobiles. Also, you know from the life, the microwave ovens. And also the microwaves are used in the accelerator fields just to accelerate the particles. We have also terahertz radiation, infrared radiation, and the most known by us, which are familiar with it, it is the visible light radiation. And of course, then we have going to the smaller and smaller wavelengths. Then we are approaching the X-ray radiation, which is in the nanometer level, at sub-nanometer level. And then at the end, we have also the gamma radiation. So in principle, for the visible radiation, of course, the most common source that is natural is the sun, the radiation coming to us, and therefore we, let's say, can see some things. So our eyes are very good detectors for this kind of radiation. But of course, to see the smaller and smaller sizes, to resolve the, let's say, molecules and to see in the atomic level, we need the shorter and shorter radiation. And here comes the X-rays, which have the wavelength, let's say, comparable with the distances of the atoms and molecules in the matter. But for this, we also need some sources of those radiation. And how to build such a good source of the X-ray radiation? So at the beginning, as you know, it was already told that we had the X-ray lamps. And the first measurements were done with the X-ray by Röntgen in 19th century, in the end of the 19th century. But actually, to have very good source of this radiation, we need a good good quality of this beam that is emitted. So how to build such a source, this is another matter. So of course, this kind of microscope, so to say, to use paradoxically is quite big. So the smaller sizes we would like to see, we need the bigger and bigger sources. So this kind of sources are the synchrotrons, for instance, and also free electron lasers. And they actually are special because they emit some special radiation, which is called the synchrotron radiation, which has quite broad also spectrum. So it's coming from the infrared radiation up to the X-rays. So the first observation actually of such a synchrotron radiation was done many years ago in 2054 by the Chinese and the Japanese astronomers, where they observe the Crab Nebula. So actually the Crab Nebula and this light, this blue light that you see on this photo, these are the radiation that is emitted by the whirling electrons around the rapidly spinning neutron star. So what is the synchrotron radiation? So when we think about the synchrotron radiation, we think about the radiation that is emitted by the electrons or the particles which are charged. And this radiation is, let's say, emitted or radiated by the particles that are accelerated. In this case, you see the electrons that are coming through the bending magnet, and the trajectory of the of it is bent, and then in the in the forward direction, tangential to the particles' movement, they emit this cone of the synchrotron radiation. The synchrotron radiation is the electromagnetic radiation that is emitted also not only just the charged particles, but they are also very fast. So they are coming almost with the speed of light. They are relativistic particles due to acceleration. And to actually describe this radiation in the more formal way, you need to derive the equation, you need to take the Maxwell equation, you need to put the charged particle and define its movement in the wave with respect to this electric and magnetic radiation. But this can be also understood with the Lorentz contraction and Doppler shift. So when you can imagine the electrons that are coming with the speed close to the speed of light, and for instance, they are approaching the periodic structure of the magnets, they see this, this is called undulator, and they see this undulator that it is moving around them in their frame, in their rest frame. So in this case, they see the length of this undulator is shorter. And this is shorter by the special value, which calls Lorentz factor, gamma. So assuming that this undulator has some periodical structure, so it means that the that the magnetic field is changing, so it's oscillating. So the electrons start to oscillate in this structure. And however, the period length of those oscillation, which called here, it's denoted as a lambda u, it's also shorter by this Lorentz factor. So they will radiate actually, so regarding the gamma or the Lorentz factor, we have this is, let's say, a relation between the energy, kinetic energy of the particle to the rest mass energy. And of course, there are the other relation that that we can denote here that might be useful later is the beta, which is the the speed of the particle divided by the speed of light. So imagine what are the, let's say, typical values of this gamma factor. Assuming that we have a source of 1.5 GV, for instance, for Solaris, if we divide this by the energy of the electrons of the rest, let's say, energy, we will get around 3,000 this gamma factor. So for the synchrotron radiation, this gamma factor is in the range of 1,000. This means that, for instance, when we have a, let's say, the period length of the undulator in the range of centimeters, for instance, then the wavelength that will be propagating it will be in the range of nanometers, but this coming also from the Doppler shift, because once the let's say particles will move, they will also change the frequency that they are emitting, or the wavelength for another gamma factor. So summing up, the particles emit the light of the wavelength, which is the undulator wavelength divided by the Lorentz factor. And then since they are also traveling towards the object, for they will reduce the wavelength for another factor of gamma, and then the observer will observe actually the radiation, which is the undulator wavelength divided by 2 gamma squared. So as I mentioned, this means that for the few centimeters radiation period of the undulator, the emitted wavelength will be in the nanometer range. So already the X-rays. So also in the moving frame of the electrons are oscillating in the periodic magnetic field with a simple harmonic motion, and therefore they emit the familiar dipole pattern that has the sinus square theta distribution that you see here. So this is something that can be known already as a dipole radiation. So the second consequence of this Doppler shift is that the angle with which the observers view the source will also be affected. And therefore, the radiation that is emitted, it appears at the vertical angle of plus minus one per gamma. So the peak emission is orthogonal to the direction of the electrons' acceleration and electrons on the circular path. The radiation is emitted in the forward cone of the tangent of the circle. So actually, if we look at these pictures here, we see that at the low electron velocities, they are emitting the radiation that is a dipole radiation pattern. However, when they accelerate close to the speed of light, then the emission is put in some kind of cone that is tangentially propagating to the trajectory of the particles in the forward direction. So regarding the bending magnet that I used to, let's say, keep the particles on the circular orbit, and the electrons travels on those arcs of circle of the radius set up at the magnetic field strength. So horizontally, you can see that the beam will sweep up as a lighthouse, and the intensity will be very flat. So vertically, it is typically plus minus one over the gamma. When we, so what is the signal of such a radiation? So the electrons in a bending magnet, as they are accelerated, they are forced to bend. And then the radiation that is seen by the observer, it is seen in the very short time. So in principle, in the time domain, we see the short signal pulse. However, when we do the FFT and we would like to see the this in the frequency domain, and we will see quite broad spectrum. The pulse duration is a time for the electrons minus time for the photons that have to come to the observers. So this is proportional to the one over the gamma to the third power. And then we also see, can derive the typical wavelength of this radiation. The other, so if we imagine that these particles move in a circle, they will circulate with some angular velocity, which is of course connected with the beta. So the electron speed divided by the radius of the circle. If we integrate the power emitted by those electrons, then we will find some additional important value, which is the critical frequency that is proportional to the gamma to the third power divided by the radius. And this critical frequency, it is telling us that at this frequency, actually we have the peak of the intensity of this radiation. And also it splits the power spectrum to the equals halves. And we also can derive from this the critical wavelength and also the critical energy, which are quite important values that I will show you. So also the other important parameters of the radiation is the radiation, the power of this radiation. So the total power from this electron beam circulating in this 360 degree circle, it's proportional to the fourth power of the energy, and linearly proportional to the beam current, and also reversely proportionally to the radius of this orbit. Because the electrons also, they radiate the power, they will lose some energy. So the energy losses per turn, per electron, it's also related with this energy to the four power. We can also derive some additional useful, let's say, values that are the power per horizontal angle, so linear power, that is also proportional to the energy, to the power of four. And then we also have the power density on axis, which is in the watts per milliradian square. And this actually is proportional to the fifth power of the energy. So if we look at some values for the real machines, here we have the synchrotron right radiation source, diamond, and ESRF. Each of it has different energies. The first 2 GeV, the second one 3 GeV, and the ESRF 6 GeV. And let's say comparable current, we can see that the amount of power that is emitted by those particles for those different sources vary quite much because of this, let's say, relation, and this that it is related to the energy up to the fourth power. And also when we compare also the power density, you can see even more of this power for the 6 GeV machine. So in principle, all of those machines can melt the vacuum chamber. Other important property of the synchrotron radiation is the flux. So the flux is the number of photons that is traveling down the beam lines per second in the certain bandwidth. We also can derive the spectral photon flux, which is given by this relation here, connected with the energy of the beam, electron beam, also the electron beam current, and the Bessel function. So this K53 is kind of it is called the modified Bessel function. If we plot this flux with respect to the energy, we can see that there is some characteristic shape of this flux. And at the critical energy, actually it drops down drastically. And if we would like to increase the flux, so what then we have to do? You can see that we need to shift this critical energy. And to actually shift this critical energy, we need to increase the bending, the energy of the photons. So here you can see some curve for the energy of 1.5 GV, then for the 2 GV, 2.5, and so on. But it is not always possible to increase the energy in the machine as it reach, for instance, the limit of the designed factor. So what can we do more? if we would like to shift the energy, the critical energy, and also shift the photon energy that is radiated by the charged particles, then we also can install some additional insertion devices in such a storage tree. And for instance, we can install some additional magnets that have, for instance, a stronger magnetic field. So such an insertion that you can compose, for instance, from three bending magnets just to not disturb the electron trajectory. Once you can install, you can see that at the same energy of the electrons, you will actually shift the photon energy to the higher levels, and you can increase also the flux in those higher energies. So in this case, by factor of 100. There are also other insertion devices that can do similar thing, or but enhance even more the flux coming from the charged particles, which are called wigglers. If we think about the wiggler, we think about the let's say array of the bending magnets that are composed in such a way that they produce the sign bending magnet field. And each of it can be thought as a source point of the radiation. So such a multiple wigglers, you can think of them in such a way that you have several of those wavelength shifters put together. They will increase the flux, and they will also shift the critical energy of the photons. So we can derive here also the other parameter that is related with the bending magnet field. It's called deflection parameter K, which is related with the magnetic field and also with the period length of this wiggler. Comparing the fluxes from those different sources, you see that for the wavelength shifter, we are actually not gaining much at the lower range of the for photon energies of flux, but we are able to shift the critical energy and also increase the flux in the higher ranges. For the multiple wiggler, a part of this, we also increase the flux by the order of two magnitudes for the lower energies. This wiggler spectrum, of course, it poses So it is radiating incoherently still. So in principle, when we look at the time structure of such pulses that are radiated by the electrons going around this wiggler, we see in the time domain several pulses that are short. But if we do the, let's say, we go to the frequency domain, we also see the broad spectrum. So actually, we see something similar like for the bending moment. And we can, of course, increase the flux by, first of all, for instance, for the magnets which has stronger magnetic field. So here you can see the comparison between one Tesla and one Tesla bending magnet and one Tesla wiggler, but with 10, let's say, poles. So as you see, it enhances the radiation thanks to that it has let's say, multiple structure. Regarding the undulator, so actually the undulator is something similar like wiggler, but is much weaker. So in this case, the deflection parameter is much less than one. And let's say the electrons that are moving in the undulator, they are bent more gently in the structure. They can emit also, of course, they will emit the synchrotron radiation, but this radiation actually will be seen as a long pulse in the time domain. Also, additionally, those radiation will interfere with each other. Therefore, in the spectrum and on the flux, let's say, chart, we will see the discrete lines that corresponding to the different harmonics of this radiation. So here you can see the undulator radiation. When the wavelength of this radiation is, of course, connected with the undulator period length and with the energy of those particles, but also with the deflection parameter. What is also important here is that we can tune the undulators to the certain wavelength value. So when we change, for instance, the magnetic strength of this undulator by, for instance, closing the gaps, then we can shift those wavelengths of those peaks of the radiated power in some direction. So actually increasing in this case, you can also see that increasing the magnetic field, we are shifting the harmonics to the lower energy photon range. So it is something that is a little bit opposite what we observed for the bending magnets and for the wigglers. Because there, when we increased the magnetic field, then we were shifting the critical energies into the higher photon energies. In this case, increasing the magnetic field, we are shifting this actually to the lower energy. But this also means that we can tune our undulators to the certain energies that we want. Regarding the power emitted from the beam coming from passing through the, let's say, bending magnet system, we can see that the total power is proportional to the square power of the energy and also to the electron to the electron current. And once we will derive this for the case of the wiggler, we'll see that it is also proportional to the bending magnet field square. And to the length, it is linearly proportional to the length of this magnet. So the power that is radiated by the multipole wiggler, it horizontally it is extending from minus to plus k over the gamma, and vertically it is contained in this plus minus one over gamma region. Comparing the total power from the undulator and from the wigglers, which are much stronger devices, we see that the power is also stronger. So in principle, those multiple wigglers, they are powerful devices. But since the undulator radiate in the small cone, then the density of the power, it can be observed that it is much higher for the undulators than for the multiple wigglers. So summarizing the types of the radiation sources, we have the bending magnets that keep the particles on the right orbit, and they will radiate a very wide horizontal cone. But the vertically it will be, let's say, plus minus one over gamma. For the wigglers, we will horizontally have limit of this radiation k over the gamma. And for the undulators, one over the number of periods per gamma. But and looking on the also spectral brightness for those devices, we can see that the undulators have very high peak brightness in with respect to the wigglers and the bending magnets. So here are the typical devices that are installed in different, let's say, facilities. You can see the 7 Tesla multiple wiggler. Unfortunately, you cannot see the structure of it, but it has the period length of 120 millimeters. And since this is the superconducting device, it has to be kept in the cryocooling system. And it needs all the cryogenic in order to make the superconductivity of this magnet keep. And then we have the normal conducting undulator, which is Apple type elliptically polarized undulator with the period length of 36.6 millimeters that it installed at Solaris. Also, the light that is emitted from the bending magnet is polarized. So most of the polarization, if we look at the, let's say, circulating beam in the storage ring for the side view, we can see that the beam will oscillate back and forth. So it will have the linear polarization, but also from a side, from top and from the beneath, we will see also some elliptical polarization. So the bending magnet radiation, when we talk about the intensity and how much it is polarized, the 7/8 part of the total intensity will be linearly polarized, and 1/8 it will be elliptically polarized. Also, the other parameter that it is important for the synchrotron radiation is coherence. When we think about the coherence, then we can think about these people who are riding on this tandem type bike. So to enhance, let's say, this this velocity of this bike and to win the race, they need to, let's say, cycle at the same way. So in phase and with the same, let's say, angular speed. When we talk about the wavelength and waves propagating, then we talk about the longitudinal coherence and also on the transversal coherence. So talking about the longitudinal coherence, it means the time coherence. It can be measured with the, let's say, Michelson interferometer, measuring the path length of the differences over which the fringes can be observed. So we usually talk about the coherence length, which is related with the wavelength divided by the spectral, let's say, width of this wavelength. And then the coherence length is the distance of propagation over this, which the radiation spectral width becomes 180 degrees out of phase. So the minimum condition for the longitudinal coherence is that this coherence length need to be higher than the wavelength. also we have to think about the spatial coherence. So then we talk about the source size. And then if we, for instance, use the slit system, we can measure the interference pattern, then we say that the light is coherent. So if we can observe the pattern for the radiation that we are sending through the pinhole, then we can say that it is coherent. If we cannot see the pattern, only just the blur, then we say that the beam is incoherent. So for the, let's say, point source size, we can derive the smallest size that you can resolve with the wavelength lambda. With this formula, that is the size of the source times the angle theta, it is equal to the radiation wavelength divided by 2 pi. So if we have the diffraction limited sources, it doesn't require the pinhole to provide the most coherent flux, because it's already within the limit. So talking about this coherence, when we think about the light bulb, it emits the chaotic, let's say, radiation. And then once we will use the pinhole, we can obtain the spatial coherence. When we use the monochromator, we can obtain the temporal coherence. And if we use both of them, we can combine and obtain the coherent, let's say, radiation in, let's say, both the temporal and the spatial region. So the most coherent, let's say, spatially and temporally is the laser beam. Also, we have other property of the beam, of the electron, sorry, of the synchrotron radiation, which is the brilliance. And the brilliance, actually, it is the flux, but divided by the source size. So in this case, we also care about the source sizes that emits the radiation. So it is proportional to the current of the electron beam. And reversely proportional to the emittance of this beam. So to increase the brilliance, we actually need the sources with the very small emittance. And because users always want to have this diffraction limited sources, we can see how much we need to decrease the emittance to actually obtain this diffraction limit. So for the assuming that we are interested in the wavelength of 1 angstrom, then the emittance that the beam should have, it should be around 8 picometer radian. So it is challenging to obtain such a small emittances, but in the vertical direction, it is already possible to get it. In the horizontal plane, we need to actually do some redesigning of the system to obtain such a small emittance. Why the brightness or the brilliance is of the interest, you can see how the different sources of the brilliance, what the sources, what different sources have what kind of brilliance. So if we compare, for instance, the 60 watt light bulb, it has the brilliance around in the order of 10 to the 6 power. The sun is brighter, and also the X-ray tubes, the conventional, in the range of 10 to 10. Then if we talk about the synchrotrons, we see that we can obtain those brilliances in a much higher level, a few order of magnitude higher than the sun. And also we can increase it by the undulator radiation, which then is proportional to the number of electrons, the intensity of this radiation. And then we can increase it even more by free electron lasers, which radiate the coherent radiation, which is proportional to the number of electrons squared, to the power. So the synchrotron light source is a unique man-made source of the electromagnetic radiation, which very broad spectral range. It is also monochromatic in a sense that we can monochromator is the beam. It's very intense. It also is collimated, has a small spot sizes. It's also polarized and has adjustable time structure, which is also of the interest for the users. Yeah, so this already was said. So it is, why those synchrotron radiations are important and of interest of different research groups, because you can do the fundamental research in the physics, chemistry, cosmology, biology, geology, also in applied research where we have the material science, also environmental, archaeological and culture heritage, in the medicine, semiconductor industries, pharmacy industry. So it is a very multidisciplinary and multi-user research facility. So regarding the first observation of the synchrotron radiation in the laboratory, because we at the beginning I said that it was many years ago observed this radiation in the space, but it was not understood well at that time. But the first observation in the laboratory, it was in 1947 in the General Electric. And they had the synchrotron and they had a vacuum tube that was transparent, and they saw the the flash of the light. So this was the synchrotron radiation. When we look on the history of the synchrotrons in the 60s, there were first generation synchrotrons, mostly composed from the bending magnets, but they were mostly used as colliders. And actually the synchrotron source light was used as a parasitic, was parasitic, so to say. So, and this was rather unwanted because once the electrons emit the radiation, they just lose the energy. So here are the first, let's say, old first generation synchrotrons. This is ACO in Orsay. It was the electron positron collider at 500 MeV. And there is also the DESI and DORIS. It was built in the 70s, also for colliding the electron and positron particles for the high energy physics. Then in the 70s, actually, they started to use the second, the synchrotrons as a for the, let's say, material research using the synchrotron radiation. And those machines were constructed with the mostly were consist of bending magnets and also some wigglers in the straight sections. But they had very high, let's say, emittance. So and also still quite low energy machines, at least for BESI and MAX1, around hundreds of MeVs. And then in 90s, the third generation of those machines appeared, which were optimized for the higher brilliance, also with the smaller electron sizes, also having some spaces for the insertion devices, mostly for the undulators. And it were the multi-user facility with also the still some low coherence. So here are the first, let's say, source, third generation sources built in 90s. So we have a ESRF, which was the 6GV machine with the circumference of 844 meters, with emittance which was in the range of 4 nanometer radian, with the current of 200 milliamps of the, let's say, circulating electrons. And it possesses the 6.3 meters straight sections for accommodating the insertion devices. And it was built in 1994. And after that, they came the other facilities. Some of them doesn't exist anymore, like for instance, MAX2, because it was replaced by the new machine. So here you can also see the most, let's say, the three generation light sources around the Europe. So that are widely used by the users. So these are the BESI, MAX4, Petra 3, SLS in Switzerland, Diamond in UK, Soleil in France, ESRF, now EBS, ALBA, light source, Eletra, and also Cezanne. So how the third generation light source looks like? Usually you have the electron source. So mostly it is, usually it is an electron gun that emits the electrons towards the, let's say, pre-accelerator, which is the LINAC. Usually those LINACs are in the range of few hundred of mega electron volts. And then the beam is injected to the booster. So the booster is the circular machine, which mainly is used for just increasing the energy of the electron beam. And after it reaches, let's say, the maximum wanted value, then it is extracted to the storage ring. And in the storage ring, it is the electron beam is circulating at the final design energy and delivering the photon beams to different beam lines. But also is what you can see here is that such a facility has actually usually several up to 20 beam lines, more than 20 in case of ESRF, for instance, and those researchers, they can do their research on different techniques at the same time and using the same source at one time. So regarding the how the accelerator is composed, you can say that you have the RF gun with some cathode. This cathode can be either thermionic or it can be photocathode. Then you also need some laser beam just to extract the electrons. Then the electrons in the gun are accelerated towards the linear accelerator. And those depends what kind of gun you have, but for instance, for the RF gun, you already prepare the bunch structure of those particles emitted by the cathode. And then they are entering the linear accelerator structure, which is composed of several, let's say, RF cavities. And the electromagnetic wave is accelerating further those particles. So the maximum acceleration, of course, the particles can gain once they are approaching the crest of the electron wavelength. And this you can imagine as a, let's say, surfer, which is going on the wave that it it's just accelerated further. So if we talk about injector, for instance, I took the example of Solaris. In this case, we have a RF gun and then several such RF structures. And then the transfer line that is transferring the particles up to the storage ring. Then there is a special magnet, septum, that is connecting actually the storage ring with the transfer line and allowing for those particles be injected and also those which are already circulated to not be affected by this magnetic field of this magnet. Then also you need some kind of kicker to just kick the beam to the orbit after the injection and store the beam. So in Solaris, we are injecting at 600 mega electron volts. So we have six such RF structures, each of which can accelerate the beam up to 100 MeV. And then this such a beam is injected to the storage ring when it is further accelerated. So we don't have a booster. So we use first the storage ring as a booster. We are increasing the energy in the storage. Of course, to supply RF to the LINAC, we also need some source of this RF. We had some kind of modulators with the klystrons that produce the microwaves that are sent out to the RF structures of the LINAC. Then we have a storage ring. The storage ring usually it is composed of magnets. So the main magnet that are keeping the beam on the right orbit are the bending magnets, but also you need some additional magnets to keep this beam. Talk about this right after. I will describe the rest of the components. So then we also need some RF system that will boost the energy of those particles once they are losing it through the radiation, synchrotron radiation that is emitted towards the beam lines. Also, you need some kind of front end that is tangential to the beam orbit, and it is actually some transition between the, let's say, machine and the beam line. And with the front end, you already extract the photons from the storage ring. And you also have a beam line, several beam lines around the circulator. So here, like it looks like in our case, and here, like in other laboratory. So for our machine, we have the maximum energy of the storage ring 1.5 GV. We use 12 bending magnets, which are not typical ones. They are quite unique because these are combined magnets in one, let's say, block of iron. And then we have a structure there of dipole magnets, also quadrupole magnets and sextuple magnets in one such a block. Normally, in the conventional, let's say, systems, you have all of those magnets separated and put on some girders. Also, we are using the 100 megahertz RF system. So regarding the magnets, we have the bending magnets. As I already mentioned, to just keep the beam circulating in the right orbit, but also from the bending magnets are also the source of the synchrotron radiation, but they also are dispersive thing, source, so they actually provide that the particles that are entering the bending magnet, they are bent in a different way. It depends what energy they have. So the faster particles, they will bend less than the, let's say, synchronous particle, and the slower particle will bend more. So then the trajectory actually will spread out. Then we also need some quadrupoles because the beam will diverge and we need to focus it So for this, there are some kind of lenses comparing to the light I used, and these are the quadrupole magnets. And those quadrupole magnets, of course, they are focusing the electron beam. However, here also we are facing some kind of problems that the particles which are high, they bend less, and those with the slower, which are slower, they will bend more or focus more. So actually the focal length will be spread out. So to correct this, let's say, effect, we need some, let's say, chromatic devices. And these are the sextuples, which act as a correctors for this effect. And they can focus the particle, correct, let's say, this the spread out of those particles. So actually, focusing sextuples, they will focus more those particles with the higher higher momentum, and they will defocus a little bit those with the lower momentum, just to get the just point of the focus of the focus. So when we talk about the storage shrink, we usually talk about some special parameters that are energy of the electrons. It is set up by the also by the circumference and by the bending magnets. Then we have some current that is circulating. So this is the number of the particles that is circulating in the storage ring. We have some emittance, so some kind of property of the beam, which is connected with the size of the beam. And also the coupling between the horizontal and the vertical plane, the natural chromaticities, which are set up by the sextuples, and the lifetime, which is saying us how long the particles can circulate in such a machine. I also have some magnetic structure of those cells. In our case, we are talking about the double band achromat. So this means that we have the two bending magnets. In between, we have some focusing element, quadrupoles, and then also some sextuples in between, just to correct for those effects that I was describing before. And then we also have the beam lines, which has it is consists of different components that that are focusing the photon beam that is emitted by those electrons. So we have some slits, we have some collimating optics, collimating mirrors. Then we have also the monochromator to monochromatize the beam, and some additional focusing components just to have small spot on the sample. And then we have some kind of detector on the end station that is analyzing the photons or photoelectrons that are coming from the sun. So here are the exemplary beam lines. At Solaris, we have now two in the operation for the users. One is the beam XAS beam line for the X-ray absorption spectroscopy and photoelectron emission microscope. So there are two end stations. The energy of the photon is in the range of from few 200 up to 2000 electron volts. And the resolving power is more than 4000. And this beamline based on the bending magnet. We also have a beamline that is using the undulator with the quite long period, well, length of 150-20 millimeters. And with the energy of 8 up to 100 electron volts used for the URPS technique. So there are certain beam properties that need some accelerator properties, that it is always the challenge to get the best properties of the photon. So the photon energy range that requires the energy of the accelerator, the magnetic field, the insertion devices parameters. Then we have the photon flux, which is related with the energy and the current of the circulated beam. Then we have the brightness, which also takes into account the emittance of the beam. So the lower emittance, the better brightness of this beam. The polarization, which is of course used changed, let's say, depending on the magnetic field orientation. It can be obtained for the different polarization can be obtained by, let's say, different insertion devices. The mostly the undulators here play a big role for the circular and elliptical polarization. And then the time structure, which is the RF frequency, and that is setting up the actually time structure, but you can also change the filling pattern of the storage ring and you will get some different time structure of the particles. Then also what is the most important is the stability of the source. And here also it is challenging to get a good correction system, the feedback system, the beam lifetime, and the injection system that doesn't disturb the beam. And the beamline capacities that is corresponding to the types of the, let's say, source, radiation sources. So going to those parameters, we are approaching the fourth generation storage rings. And for this, let's say, diffraction limited storage rings, they are similar to the, say, third generation storage rings, but we are pushing the beam to the physical limit by optimizing the emittance and optimizing the brilliance of the electron of the photon beam. And they also become spatial coherent, and they started to appear. So here are some facilities that already built and commissioned the fourth generation storage ring. The pioneering was the Max 4 3GB machine. with the emittance of 0.323 nanometer radian, and the circumference of roughly 500 meter. Then recently the ESRF was upgraded as well, which was the first third generation machine with the electron beam of 6 GV. And now it is a fantastic machine that was recently commissioned and obtained the design parameters of the emittance, which is low, quite low. They reached 0.135 nanometer radians. And we have also Sirius in Campinas. They started parallelly most sort of commissioning of those machines with the circumference close to the max four circumference and the emittance in between those two facilities. So the emittance, as I said, it is the, let's say, when we talk about the phase space, it's the size of the beam in this phase space related to the position and the angle of the electrons. It is related to the beam size. Of course, the quantum nature of the synchrotron radiation emission is responsible for the finite beam size emittance and the energy spread of the electron beam. And because it is oscillating due to emission of the photons, and the angle or the momentum of those particles will change, then it will be restored partially in the electron in the RF cavities, but it will, let's say, oscillate due to this emission of the photons. So actually, it is challenging to obtain very small emittances for those rings, and how to reduce the emittance, it is something that people spend nights and day to think of and optimizing it. You can imagine that the emittance, which is also related to the dispersion, it is related to the energy and to the to the radius, so also the circumference of the machine can be optimizing by decreasing the dispersion, first of all. Also, you can decrease the energy, but this is actually not something that you want, because you want also the high energy photons, which are related to the energy. So in principle, to have high energy photons and very good emittance, you also need to increase the circumference, because the bigger circumference it is going to the power of three, then when we're talking about the increasing the circumference, we are talking about increasing the number of the dipoles. But those machines then become very big, and this is something that also needs to be optimized due to the costs. And then you can end up with some different structure of the unit cells of those machines. So they also provide some additional factor that can be that can reduce the emittance. So going from this third generation double band achromats or triple band achromats, which already have the small factor, we are ending up with the multi-band achromats, which have much more dipoles, therefore the emittance will decrease even more. Yeah. So this is how the let's say, optical function around the synchrotron looks like. For the three generation light source where the dispersion is in the range of 0.3 meters, and then for the fourth generation light source where this dispersion is reduced of the one order of the magnitude. So further emittance reduction, we can also optimize the design of the magnet using some kind of combining the different, let's say, contents of this magnet and obtaining the, so to say, the damping partition number, which will be higher than normally it is around one. Also, you can reduce the, further reduce the emittance in the designed storage ring by introducing some additional, let's say, wigglers, which called the damping wigglers, which will allow to radiate more power, and therefore they will reduce the emittance even more. So here are the chart of the emittance in nanometer radians for different storage rings. With respect to this, to the energy of the storage ring, and you can see what is the trend now. So the new third generation light source, they are decreasing the emittance. And then going towards the fourth generation light sources, those diffraction limited sources, they are reducing it up to the below one nanometer level. And now the all eyes are look at the Petra 4, which is also in the design phase of the diffraction limit light source with aiming for the emittance in the range of 10 of picometers. So there are some challenges of designing this this fourth generation light sources. We are have the small emittance, but this comes with the very strong focusing and ultra stable beams. So they need strong focusing magnets, the also strong sextuples, but this also provides to high chromaticity effect. And also amplitude dependent tune shifts, some intra beam scattering because the electrons are so close to each other. Also, small radiuses which decrease the momentum compaction, small dynamic apertures and momentum acceptance, some injection problems. And lifetime issues, some instabilities coming along this the small emittances, which will blow up again this emittance and will provide some transverse oscillation. And those about the strong sextuples are requires the small, let's say, gaps also than the small vacuum chamber. So for those new sources, the vacuum chambers are in the range of 1 cm, 1.5 cm. So it is also challenging to produce such chambers, also to neck coat them. They also required some compact design of the magnets and very good alignment, because all of this will be added to the stability of the beam. So of course this all design requires some optimization. For instance, these integrated magnet blocks, which then provide a bit better stability on they will also shift, for instance, the vibration frequencies to the higher level. Also, this requires small gaps, as I already said. Also, the dipoles with some introducing some defocusing gradient, some octopoles, narrow vacuum chambers, and reduction of the ion pumps and all the vibration, let's say, components. Yeah, so stable, and also some cavities, the of course main cavities, but also some third harmonic cavities, which will a little bit stretch the bunches, prevent from the IBS effect, and also increase the lifetime, and some injection with the multiple kickers. There are also other fourth generation sources, which are free electron lasers. They were invented in 70s as well, and they are optimized for the high peak brilliance, also high coherence. They based on the LINAC-driven free electron laser sources. They can also use a small number of users, unfortunately. So this is some kind of disadvantage to the or comparison to disadvantage to the facility that it has only just few beam lines, few groups to doing the experiment at the same time. And there is a number of those machines that were built already around the world. So we have LCLS in US with the 15 GV electron beam with the 230 femtosecond pulses. It is operating in the S-band structures. We have in Japan, SAKLA, on the C, it is based on the C-band LINAC with the 60 Hertz rep rate. And it delivers the beam at around 8.5 GV. We have the XFEL in Hamburg with 70 GV electron beam, and the superconducting LINAC technology, also flash at the same place. And we have also the Fermi at Electra, which is the 1.5 GV machine. We're talking about the maximum energy. It also based on the S-band technology. So here are the main parameters, but I don't have much time to describe all of this. But you can also see that the power of those beams are very high, in the range of tens of gigawatts of power, and they are very short, they're producing very short pulses in the range of femtosecond, with the high also peak current. So when we talk about free electron laser, we are talking about coherent, let's say, emission of the synchrotron radiation, which happen once the electron is passing through the very long undulator and interact with the radiation emitted by itself. So after some time, this beam starts to be modulated in the density, and then it is modulated even more. And you can see here some microstructure of this beam, which is very short, and then also radiate coherently from this microstructure. And those radiation adds up, and then we get the high, very high radiation from this beam. And at the end, it reaches the saturation, and it is at the end overbunched even. So there is some kind of fluctuation of this, let's say, bunching after all. So the coherent radiation intensity then is proportional to the number of those electrons to the square. There are different schemes of those FELs. So this is kind of the resonant FEL, where you have two mirrors around the undulating structure. The electrons, once they are passing through, they will interact with the radiation that is emitted by them, but it is captured between those mirrors. And however, it is not used in the LINAC FELs. So for the LINAC FELs, mostly there are SASE techniques, where you have the spontaneous emission, self-amplified spontaneous emission, which was described on the previous slide, but also to, let's say, enhance the coherence of this photon beam, and also the micro bunches. It can be seeded by the laser pulse. So the beam is coming through, but it is also through this structure is sent the laser pulse. Then interacting the electron beam interacting with the seeded laser have the energy modulation, which then it is let's say convert to the density modulation once you will slip the structure, and then you will get the micro bunches, which are coherent, and also the pulse will be much intense.
Also, excuse me, Adriana, but we are running very, very late here. So can I start you to start closing your presentation?
Okay, so I will finish. So there are also the other schemes of the FELs. So we have AGHG, high gain harmonic generation. We have echo enable harmonic generation, two colors FELs. Then the other sources like the energy recovery, LINAC, also inverse Compton scattering sources. And all of this gives some unique, let's say, characteristic of the radiation, and then can be used for different matter studies. Also, we have recently developed plasma wake fit accelerators. So this I will skip because this was covered by the other lectures. But as you can see, this high coherent radiation and very bright radiation, this allows for the different studies of the matter with the, let's say, first you can do much faster the experiments and you can see much more details of those matters. And with this, I would like to finish. So only just with one conclusion that the synchrotron radiation light source is the unique source of the electromagnetic radiation with which is widely used in the research. So thank you very much for your attention and sorry for this long speech.